as ESPN3 brings you coverage of Big East women's volleyball. This afternoon, the 15-7 Marquette Golden Eagles start their four-match conference road trip against the 12-14 St. John's Red Storm. And with that, we say a pleasant good afternoon to you courtside. Alongside former St. Francis Brooklyn assistant Patrick Dietz, I'm Oquan Sonye. Tonight's matchup features two teams on opposite ends of the offense-defense spectrum. Patrick, NCAA's top 20 in blocks, that belongs to St. John's. For Marquette, top 15 in every offensive category.
Top 15 for a reason. They have probably one of the best outside hitters in the Big East right now. But of course, St. John's has one of the best blocking teams in the Big East. When you have Denisha and Julia up front, not a lot of people get that ball past them. So really, it's going to be a battle of wills. Which team is going to be able to set their table the right way?
Our spotlight players were both named the co-freshman of the year in the Big East. And for St. John's, it starts with their quarterback in a sense, in Erica DiMaulo.
And what a quarterback she's been all year. Yes, St. John's has struggled, but Erica DiMaulo has not. She's found a way to set the table every time for this young team. Being able to put the ball in key, solid spots so that the offense can run smoothly. Now the question is, will she be able to do that against Marquette's vaunted serving?
And on the other side for Marquette, setting the pace for their fantastic offense, the sophomore outside hitter, Allie Barber.
And Allie Barber became the co-freshman of the year last year because of her ability to find good shots. She went off towards the end of last year, and it's just carried into this year, hitting 4.96 kills per set. This young lady is on a tear and helping Marquette basically be on the cusp of top 25 in the NCAA.
With that, first serve comes your way next on ESPN3. St. John's and Marquette looking to square off as both teams are returning to familiar territory. Marquette hits the road yet again. St. John's is back at home as Jordan McCullough, Kaylee Wood start on the outside. Julia Cast and Jordan McCullough will finish that lineup. In the middle, Hannah Wagner and Denisha Moss and Amanda Sanabia, the libero, opens with first serve. The first swing from Allie Barber, taken in by Sanabia. First swing of the night for Wood in the back row, taken by Anna Hawk. And coming through up front, Lauren Speckman, the setter.
Lauren Speckman did a great job right there. She noticed that the block was holding and waiting for her decision. Yeah, the block did go up a little late, but she found that little chop shot dump right there.
Speckman taking over the offense from Sarah Blazier, who graduated last year, a legendary setter for Marquette. Came on really strong in the offseason. However, due to a dispute, it'll be St. John's point instead.
A little touch shot off the top of the block right there, called by the Lions judge. And the up official, Tim Wagner, agreed with the contact.
Tim Stewart up top, Jim Kramer on the bottom, Burt Manning and Pierre Carl calling the sidelines. Glad you're joining us this Friday afternoon as Allie Barber dug up by Sanabia again. And the tip shot from Wood taken in by Speckman yet again. Barber trying to target Sanabia, nothing doing. And Cass with the first swing of the night gets her first kill.
You'll notice right now that St. John's is really putting pressure on the opening serve receive of Hope Worsh, number 8 of Marquette. They're really going to attack her right now, especially coming out of that left back zone. They don't think that she can pass consistently coming out of there.
Here's Erica DeMolo serving for St. John's. Going right for that back row, and Barber swings out of bounds. And so far, St. John's is doing a great job on that first serve and also with their swings to make sure that Barber doesn't get comfortable touches.
Yeah, exactly. That's the idea. They don't want her swinging on an open net. They're attacking a specific zone on serve receive.
And up the middle, there's Hope Wirch. Cast set up once more. Kanavidoff cleans it up. Wirch blocked up front. Marquette goes one more time. Barber dug up by Sanabia. So far, a great rally to open up tonight's match. DeMolo sets it up. And Wood, with the attempted tip shot, couldn't get it over the net.
That was a little bit of an error right there by DeMolo. She left that, kind of stuck it to her hand just a little bit. She wasn't able to give the great location that she's normally known for on a clean dig like that.
That'll send back Allie Barber to serve. Barber, the reigning co-freshman of the year. And credit the ace for Marquette. One of the best in the conference in doing so.
In the first matchup with these two teams, you saw a clean sweep by Marquette. The competition wasn't really close. But St. John's has since then changed their offense and changed the way that and their approach against Marquette. You can see it right now in the way they're playing.
Service error will give the ball back to St. John's. And here come the string of substitutions. And that'll send Delaney D'Amore to serve for the Red Storm.
Delaney D'Amore, who was the starting libero at the beginning of the year, is now the first person off the bench because she has such a great serve. She's now the starting DS. Has this incredible ability putting the ball in good locations. And that's what St. John's is hoping they can do right now for them.
Targeting Manon Jaquan. There's D'Amore with a fantastic dig in the back. And coming through with the big swing. Jordan McCullough, kill number one.
The Grapevine Texas native is doing a great job this year developing better shots. Right there you saw one inside seam low from the outside hand of the outside blocker.
Down the line, Sanabia's dig goes out of bounds. That's the first swing and kill of the night for Elizabeth Orth. She's one of 7 freshmen on this Marquette roster.
Amanda Sanabia has earned the libero job, and you can see why. She's in a good spot. Yeah, that was a tough dig, but that was basically an open net right there for Orth.
There's Wagner up the middle. Swing goes out of bounds. Point Marquette.
That's a good sign, however, for St. John's when they're able to run their offense and they're able to get good passes. That will start to free up the outside hitters against this Marquette block.
There's Marco Kanavanov winning the libero job all season. And the big block up front from Jenna Rosenthal, the all Big East first teamer.
You saw a block move right there. Marquette runs kind of what is known as a bunch read, where everyone's kind of stacked towards that middle cylinder area. They were able to actually get to the outside because they saw the pass.
Off the block, Anna Hawk comes through, the Miami transfer with her first kill of the night.
Anna Hawk's not a super big jumper, but she's a very smart swinger. She's able to find the top of the hands and tool the top of the block and get some bigger points.
Just like that, Marquette has rattled off four straight points. The overpass gives Marquette an easy swing. Davalo took a tough one to the face, and Sanabi has to send over another free ball. This time it's Rosenthal.
Marquette's going to want to set Rosenthal as often as possible on a free ball situation. She's a better offensive threat against Hannah Wagner than she would be against Denisha Moss.
With that, Joanne Persico wants to talk things over, and St. John's on the wrong side of a 5-end spike from the Marquette Golden Eagles. Let's head to break. Well, the Marquette Golden Eagles have taken control early and set number one, rattling off five straight points. And we welcome you back to the broadcast of Wasonia Patrick Deets on the fourth side. As five becomes six with the errant swing up front.
And what's going on is exactly what we talked about in the opening. Can St. John's' serve receive withstand the tough serving from Marquette? That's really where they struggled a lot when they were up at Marquette earlier this year.
Davalo trying to set it at the net for an easy swing for Wagner. Marquette has started to pull away.
Erica Davalo flew into the pole and the referee stand right there. Coach Persico got up to see if she's okay.
Thankfully, she is. Now, a little out of sorts, St. John sends up a free ball, but Hannah Wagner comes through with the solo block.
Hannah Wagner did a great job right there holding her hands high and allowing her body to just get in front of the hitter's shoulders and see the turn and jump into that swing. It's a very good job of remembering your scouting report.
And now she's back at the service line after a time where she was subbed out for, and Wagner very good at the service line for St. John's. But the block up front gives a point and ball back to Marquette.
That was actually a very good play. Denisha Moss was there. There's a little bit of space between her and the net, so the Marquette hitter was able to squeeze that ball through.
Hope works serving for Marquette. McCullough threw the block this time. Zenavia digs the Hawk swing. Wood blocked up front. Rosenthal and Hawk combined.
That's the second time that we've had a good, clean dig from Amanda Zenavia or Delaney D'Amour. And Damalo went back set to Haley Wood, and easily Marquette was there. There might be a situation where there's a scouting report saying, hey, when she gets a dig and she has to run one way, she's going to reverse set reverse the flow, as we call it. So now maybe there's going to be a little adjustment on St. John's part to know that and set a different type of offense.
And that'll hopefully make Amanda Sanabia's job easier, not having to worry too much. But as she threw one arm out there, big swing from Marquette yet again, showing why they pace in the top 15 of the NCAA in offense. Allie Barber will return from Manon Geoffroy, who was her defensive replacement. And here's Anna Hawk, aforementioned, to serve. Hawk, the transfer from the University of Miami, notched a career-high 19 kills in the win against Creighton. But her service area will give St. John's the ball back.
This is the lineup that St. John's really likes having front row with DeMarlo, Moss, and Cass front row. It's good blocking, good defensive transitioning, and of course, easy offense.
Jordan McCullough with this serve. Rosenthal blocked up front. Over goes a free ball. Here's Cass, and she gets it past the sprawl of Anna Hawk.
There you saw an example of why they love this front row right there. Julia Cast is committed to blocking the side behind the setter or blocking the setter. As a result, she was able to go one-on-one with the slide and really allow Denisha Moss the freedom to reign around the net.
Sanabia digs it. Cast keeps it alive, and Sanabia sends over a free ball. Here's Barbara once more off the hands of DeMarlo.
Believe it or not, that's actually a very good matchup for St. John's more than it is for Marquette. Yes, Barbara's taller, has a great range of shots, but DeMarlo is a very smart blocker. She's going to do what is known as touch blocking, stopping the ball barely, giving the offense an opportunity to get around her.
There's Cass beating the double block.
Defense, I apologize. They have the defense work around her because she takes smart block moves and takes away zones, allowing Amanda Sanabia or Delaney D'Amore an opportunity to really see where to set up for their digs.
And this is why it's really important for St. John's having a setter who's 6 foot is able to sort of be a Swiss Army knife offensively. But the net violation will give Marquette the point.
A little unlucky right there for St. John's. Very good defensive move. That ball's a little tight. DeMarlo went up looking to power tip it, and on her follow-through, caught the top of the net.
Rotation starts over again with Speckman notching the ace.
We call that on the beach the hubby wife. You usually have to go get a lawyer when you see two people battle over a ball and neither one of them move.
This time, Lexi Lobdell, who just checked in, pulls it in. And the double touch from Marquette will give St. John's the point and possibly some much-needed momentum. St. John's wearing their alternate red uniform with navy shorts. Marquette in their light blue tops, navy shorts. DeMarlo to serve for the Red Storm. Up the middle, Wirsch dug up. Wagner responds up the middle.
There was a situation right there where you saw how St. John's block can almost ignite their offense. Being able to soft touch that ball gives Amanda Sanabia or any defensive player back there an easy touch, and then they're able to run tempo off that good touch.
Works with the swing. Nice dig in by Sanabia. Wood up front. Once more, great dig by Sanabia off of the big swing from Wirch. Cast cut shot. This time it's Wirch. And Wood mishandles the unlucky St. John's roll.
Unlucky is right. They were there defensively. She was in the right spot. And then all of a sudden, watch how this tip doesn't clear the net completely. And it hits the top and it really foils Haley Wood's ability to play the ball.
A lot happening at once to ask her to sort of step back. But there comes another race as Allie Barber matches her second of the match.
Once again, it's that serve-receive that they really struggle with. They really need to find a way to attack this serve.
This time it goes straight into the net. And Patrick, this is a Marquette team that lost a lot of pieces. Two go to graduation. They're starting setter. They're starting LeBaron, starting middle blocker, and Megan Neiman, who set countless records. But then Taylor Lewis transfers to Ohio. So this is a pretty fresh group still coming together, but have still managed to make their way into the Big East top four.
And it's really because of the tenacity of the coach and how he's gone out and trained his players, no matter what age they are, whether they're freshmen or sophomores. There's an expectation of them to step in and step up right away.
Anna Hawk is pleading with the up official, Tim Stewart, for a touch on the hand. But to no avail. So, 4-point lead for Marquette. D'Amour serves. And Elizabeth Orff puts it away.
Elizabeth Orff made a great move right there. Came around quickly, tracked the ball, found the ball. What we say is put the ball away. As soon as you see that the block is late, hit a little crossbody shot right there.
There's McCullough blocked up front, but out of bounds, point, St. John's.
Jordan McCullough has done an excellent job this year as a freshman, not just stepping in as a big hitter, but helping out Coach Joanne Persico that you see right there find a new offensive threat, since, you know, this is Julie Cast's senior year. They're basically going to have to build this offense around her and Haley Wood for next year.
What a scramble for the second pass, but Denisha Moss still puts it away for her first kill of the night.
That is, you will never see that happen a lot. A perfect pass from the middle. Hannah Wagner steps in. And then the other middle, Denisha Moss, the human wall, steps up with her offensive ability this time.
Off the slide, Wirch beats the block off the hands of Jordan McCullough up front. And Marquette in the lead, 20-16, looking to take control and take away set number one.
Hope Wirch right there ran a very good slide. She's probably the highest jumper on the Marquette team.
Set from Moss up the middle, blocked up front. Jenna Rosenthal with Lawrence Beckman.
Again, there goes that bunch read situation where the blockers are in tight into that middle area. So it's not much of a move for Rosenthal to get there and seal that gap space, that 31B shoot low ball in the middle. So because they run that bunch read, it's really simple for them to just, oh, that's where the ball is. I'm going to drop. I'm going to take a little hop step, close that little seam, and take away that shot.
For St. John's, who struggled for five sets with Xavier last Sunday before coming away with the five-set win, now sort of have to regroup against a Marquette team that they play against really well here in Carnesecca Arena.
Yeah, you and I were talking before the open today. Not a lot of people like going to the Upper Peninsula. Not a lot of people like going to play Marquette at Marquette. A, it's cold. Even in the summer, it's freezing. And B, it's just a really long ride. And once you get there, you really have to adjust to a lot of things. It's not a big metropolis. It is a small city. And as a result, you're not used to having those creature comforts. And then you've got to play a volleyball game. And then you got to play a volleyball game against a team that all they do is reload, which is something St. John's used to do in the past, but have struggled with finding those little pieces. You know, you get the DeMalos, you get the Casts, you get the Mosses. But every year, Marquette has found a way to always be competing for top 25 in the nation.
St. John's trying to get back there, and Wood out of the back row, trying to help him at the very least salvage the set.
And to finish that point, Marquette has been one of those teams that, since they've joined the Big East, has always found a way to be in the top four, top five, top six of the Big East. So you have to match that. You have to match that in skill and in talent.
And Haley Wood comes through again with the ace.
And if you look at the length of Marquette, they look like they're a really long, tall team, and they play that way.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. blocked. Diamore cleans it up. McCullough blocked up front, but out of bounds. And St. John's, for the first time since it was 3-1 to open the match, is within two.
And this is the kind of rally St. John's is looking to do right now. They need this kind of run. Good defense, good blocking, good transition.
Off the slide, Jenna Rosenthal off the hands of McCullough.
That's definitely a matchup in favor of Marquette. That slide move towards McCullough is exactly what Marquette would like to run against her. Rosenthal is longer, taller, and can extend high over McCullough's block.
Sixth best in the Big East in attack percentage is Rosenthal, 358. And Patrick and I have been saying this all season long, whenever you can set the middle and get her involved, bodes well for your offense, and Rosenthal has been a big beneficiary of that so far.
Exactly, and her being efficient and consistent in the middle for Marquette has allowed someone like Allie Barber to get up near 5 kills per set, hitting in the high 400s. That's just an awesome job by your middle helping out the rest of the team.
Sarah Rose serving for Marquette. St. John's down 3. Barber once again. Oh, the double block of DeMolo and Moss.
The strategy of soft blocking Allie Barber is actually working. It's just that St. John's is getting a little unlucky. That ball was high and close enough to the court that someone could have run it down, but they weren't able to get there.
Barber standing at 6'5", and a few inches on the rest of the team, and the attempted dump by DeMolo. Barber said nothing doing, and it's set point for the Golden Eagles.
There was that issue with serve receive right there. That ball traveled too far for DeMolo. It was smart of her to try to tip it, but she couldn't do much else with it.
Low serve. And the double touch from Moss in set number one as the Marquette Golden Eagles take it 25-19. Strong performances from Allie Barber and Hope Wirch paved the way to set number two. We head. Marquette leads the match 1-0. Back after this, we'll return on ESPN3. This young Marquette team came ready for business this Friday afternoon as they lead the match 1-0 against St. John's. Welcome back to Carnesecca Arena. Unkwa Sunya alongside Patrick Dietz. And speaking as a coach, you can relate, Patrick Dietz, to Ryan Tice, his fourth season as the head coach, just continuing the excellence there is for Marquette.
Yeah, and to be honest with you, Ryan's been in the business a long time. I've known of Ryan. I don't know him personally. But I've watched him from afar, watching him develop as a coach from every program that he's been as an assistant. And now with what he's doing here at Marquette, you can tell the lineage of where he's been and how he's developed. You can see how he's translated taking over a program that was perennially in the top five of the Big East and finding ways to just keep reloading, rebuilding, and doing better with every girl that he gets. So he's taken a young team and made that team play as if they were a group of juniors and seniors.
Tyson, his fourth season at Marquette, has taken the Golden Eagles to the NCAA tournament in each of his years, with the Big East regular season and tournament title back in 2013 to boot. So this is nothing new for Tyson, who actually started his career as a volleyball player before University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee discontinued their program. He was not only the coach, but was also a starting player on the club team, ended up managing the women's volleyball team his senior year, and from there, head stops at Northwestern, Indiana, Eastern Illinois, University of Florida, perennially a strong volleyball program, before going to the NCAA four times as the head coach of the Ohio Bobcats out of the Mid-American Conference.
And again, you can see the lineage of people that he's learned from, especially when he was at Florida with Mary Wise. You could tell the amount of knowledge that he gained there. And it's just helped him become a more well-rounded coach that's helping this team be a more well-rounded team at such a young age.
But back to the match at hand, the service error gives St. John's the early lead. Elizabeth Orff had other ideas. Great dig in the back. And Marquette gets the point on the double touch.
Erica DeMarlo has just gotten called twice for hands on really questionable balls that maybe were a little tight to the net. It's almost as if she's tentative with her way that she's releasing the ball.
Here's Allie Barber for Marquette serving. Sanabia sprawls again. Dug beautifully by Hawk off the McCullough swing, and Hope Wertz comes through again. Team high fourth kill of the match.
Anna Hawk, the transfer from Miami, but from Sweden, has done nothing but develop better court knowledge since she's gotten here.
Here's Wood's first swing of the set, kept alive by Kapava. And right there on the attack, Marquette comes through again, and a Hawk, you just mentioned, comes through.
That kill right there out of the middle by Elizabeth Orff was a really smart tip shot into the middle of the court, that little donut area. But it happened so quick from such a high altitude.
Big swing from McCullough, scooped up by Speckman. And the block up front. What a swing by Anna Hawk yet again.
Again, that was a situation where the St. John's blockers did not get their hands across the net. We tell our blockers to penetrate the net, seal over the top, make sure your elbows are past it so that the hitters don't have a lot of room.
And that's a service ace yet again for Allie Barber. It's her third of the match.
Delaney D'Amore is struggling with serve receive, which is something I've never said all year. And we've done a few St. John's games. This is the first time I've seen Delaney actually struggle with her serve receive, and that is because of the way Marquette is serving this ball. They are attacking low inside seams, but they're dropping the ball so low that you're not sure if it's going to hit the top of the net.
Marquette reels off five straight points. St. John's needs to talk things over. Back after this on ESPN3. Right in the middle of play, McCullough sends it over for St. John's. And Hope Wirtz attacking DeMarlo gets the kill for Marquette.
They're setting Hope Wirtz way off the net. Normally you'd see a set maybe a foot and a half to 2 feet off the net. They're setting her almost 5 feet off the net to help her hit around that long St. John's block.
And Hope Wirtz, a match high five kills between both sides. But notching the back line, coming right back with it, St. John's.
Believe it or not, the St. John's is actually playing very well. I know their hitting numbers don't look great right now. They're hitting .091, but they have three players hitting over 400. It really is just a couple of points here and there that's the difference.
Service errors like that don't help. It was Kaylee Wood who notched the last point for St. John's. That'll leave it to Martha Kanavadov to serve. Freshman out of Sugar Grove, Illinois. Over 1,600 gigs at Rosary High School, but Denisha Moss put that out of her reach.
That's Denisha's third swing, first kill. And in reality, Denisha's really worked hard on her offense.
So far swinging at 333. And the wildness pays off for St. John's.
That ball came off the block, off DeMarlo, off of, incorrect. It went off of Kaylee Wood and then off DeMarlo's head. Easy ball. There might be a discussion of if this was what is known as a lift. So you're only allowed to contact the ball one time, so it could have been in one attempt. However, in the first contact, to inform everyone, you're allowed to almost mangle the ball as long as you don't catch it and throw it.
And so, that's what Coach Dice is trying to clear up with the up official.
And he just got a yellow card for continuously arguing this call.
And now it's Lauren Speckman, who is the one Marquette representative allowed to have words with the up official.
Only the court captain is allowed to talk to the up official. So as a result, she's basically the go-between the referee and the head coach. But to continue with that play, that ball kind of looked like, it did look like it rolled down Haley Wood's body and then back up. So that could have been called what is known as a lift or a scoop, as some people might call it.
Instead, it's 7-4 Marquette still. Very low dig. Block up front from Moss. Going through the block, Wood digs it up. Here's McCall off the hands. Jaffa picks it up. Tipped from Hawk. This time McCall registers.
Something happened right there in the middle of that play that if you're our volleyball coach and you have young players, you teach them how to do this. Denisha Moss could not get back into the middle. As a result, Erica DeMarlo ended up staying in the middle and becoming the middle blocker. And Denisha took over the right side blocking duties and did a great job of deflecting that ball to start that point off.
Sanabia with a fantastic dig. Here's McCullough yet again. Blocked up front. Sanabia keeps it alive. And Diamore sends over a free ball. Set for the side. And right down the line. Anna Hawk missed it. And it's 7-6 Marquette.
Great hustle play, great transitional play for St. John's. Able to get that ball back over twice. And then a outswing, basically, by Hawk.
They'll set Hawk once more. Off the block, what a dig up front. Joust at the net, Moss wins it. Marquette keeps it alive. Now over a free ball, Hawk sends. Moss in the back row, and we're tied.
And these are the plays that St. John's needs. Great transitional play again by Denisha Moss. Able to find that ball. She first attacked that first free ball and knew, hey, that's coming down on my side. I'm going to force that ball over. Able to transition. Not a great play for Marquette. St. John's gets a free ball. And again, Erica DeMarlo finding her touch again, finding her rhythm, being able to set Denisha Moss on that quick slide behind her.
And quickly, the moods have changed on both sides. Now it's St. John's with a little extra pep in their step, while Marquette, as we mentioned near the top of the broadcast, still a young team, still trying to figure things out. And so far, the past 5 points that have gone St. John's way, sort of emblematic of that.
Yeah, exactly. And it really does come down to the ability of St. John's to stay within themselves. It is a senior-laden team. Being able to play consistently through tough points, being able to play tenaciously through tough points, and earn the end. Yes, Marquette may be a slightly bigger, more athletic team in some respects, but there are great athletes on the St. John's side that need to remember that they play volleyball just as equally well and consistently find a way to get the ball back over, and basically just frustrate the life out of Marquette.
And that's going to be thanks to the tutelage and the leadership of the only coach this program's ever known, Joanne Persico, in her 24th season. As this St. John's program wants to go back to the glory days, it's already the 10-year anniversary of the St. John's team that went to the NCAA tournament as Big East champs.
They were back-to-back Big East champs.
Rosenthal gets it back right out of Woods' reach, and it's 8-7 Marquette.
Sorry, Quentin. There was that matchup again they wanted. They want to get Rosenthal on that high slide with tempo, with speed, up against Jordan McCullough.
A little bit of a different feel to this match all of a sudden, as St. John's down in the match, 2-1 set to nothing, rather, trying to climb back into it. Hawk dug up by Sanabia. Deal Moore dunks it up again. This time it's Rosenthal off the slide, and Sanabia couldn't quite get it over.
Two digs that went back over the net to Marquette, allowed Marquette to run their offense, run their system. Unfortunately, a little unlucky at the end there.
Moss running the slide as well. Taken in the back by Wirch. And the block up front goes out of bounds. Yet another kill for Anna Hawk. And in a game where you'd expect Allie Barber to take the absolute lead, it's Anna Hawk with 4 kills of her own.
Anna Hawk's been on the court basically this whole set. We haven't seen Allie Barber on the court because of the way that Marquette is playing defense.
Out of the back row, here's Jordan McCullough off the net and off of Rosenthal. Point St. John's.
And here comes Julia Cast back into the court. This is the lineup that every time St. John's has them on the court, they're able to really hone in on their defense and get good transitional points.
Let's see if Jordan McCullough can pace them from the service line. Instead, it goes out of bounds.
Jordan has kind of a hybrid float top spin that she'll hit it a certain way, and when she hits it that way, that ball will either drop really fast or, unfortunately, like it did there, carry a little further than you want it to go.
All time, Marquette leads the series 12 matches to 5. As the ball had to send it over, and some extra wild play, this time results in a Marquette point.
Once again, it makes it easier for Marquette to know where to block when St. John struggles with serve receive.
Hannah Hawk serves once more. Moss blocked up the middle. This time it's for Cast. The joust at the net. Won by Speckman, but doesn't matter. Goes out of bounds, and St. John's gets the point.
Denisha Moss did the smartest thing there. She let the ball come down. She attacked it early into Speckman's hands, and Speckman came up late and actually pushed that ball just out of bounds.
Amanda Sanabia back to serve, making the Big East weekly honor roll with her fantastic defensive performance against Providence. But here comes Marquette again. Allie Barber gets back in the kill column.
Marquette has started passing the high, deep serves of St. John's, which is where they were attacking earlier, with their hands, allowing them to tempo the pass a little better, locate the pass a little better, and allow Marquette to run speed with their serve receive.
And the serve just dies inside the line, and Jenna Rosenthal, service ace number 80 on the year.
That's a great location serve right there. That ball carried into the deep corner, pretty much a coffin corner, one of the hardest spots to pass on the court.
Trying to get it again. St. John's keeps it alive. Wagner gets it over, and Marquette sends over a free ball. Set for Wagner again. Beckman cleans it up.
Barber taken by Sanabia, whose pass goes over.
Barber once more gets the triple block. Cass keeps it alive.
DeMolo the attack. Joust at the net. Won by Speckman of Marquette.
That's twice you've seen Speckman do what is expected of someone on a joust. Be the second to contact it, not the first, because you can then redirect that ball in such a way that you'll win the point. She did it against Denisha Moss and was a little late and ended up pushing it out. This time she did it smartly against Hannah Wagner. And watch as she lets Wagner make the move and then pushes it under Wagner's arms, unlike when Denisha Moss basically came over the top and she was forced to push it deeper and further away.
That Speckman coming up with one hand, and we talked about it earlier, the difference of setter heights can sometimes change the way they play, but Speckman was unafraid of the 5-6 inch difference between her and Hannah Wagner.
Speckman is listed at 5'9", and Hannah Wagner is listed at 6'3". And in reality, height only comes into play when the two are equal in athleticism. Because, I mean, LeBron James is 6'9". Okay? LeBron James dunking at 6'9" isn't like me dunking at 6'1". There's less effort. But if I'm 6'9", with my athleticism, say, when I was in my 20s, against LeBron James and his girth, and we're equal, then there is something there. Speckman, knowing full well that Hannah Wagner is going to be bigger than her, goes, okay, yeah, I'll let you make contact first. Oop. Push right back underneath your arms, because as your arms are extending, I'm able to slide that ball underneath your arms just past the net onto the court.
Those little things have been making the difference so far. As Marquette is just 1 point over their season average in attack percentage, leading the conference at 280. So far swinging at a 281 clip this match. Sanabia's overpass taken full advantage of by Allie Barber.
Few more serve-receive struggles. That's not typical of St. John's from Sanabia or Diamore.
That's four straight points for Marquette, six of the last seven. Cass tries to end it. Hawk digs. This time Barber. Beats the hands of Speckman.
That was a great play for St. John's in terms of being able to get a point off of a good offensive-defensive transition by Marquette.
Marquette receiving votes in the coaches' poll. And this is a weekend where St. John's needs to win out to sort of stay in the conversation for a top four seed to go to the tournament. Hosted by Marquette. And Hannah Wagner puts it away.
We saw earlier where Hannah Wagner didn't seal the net up against Hawk for Marquette. But this time she was able to get across the net and see how she penetrates the net and able to block that ball away because she was able to seal the top and take away that sharp seam.
Barber right off of Sanabia again. Now we start to see why Barber's responsible for nearly five kills a set.
I'm going to give Speckman credit for that kill by Barber. She fooled the St. John's block.
But the Speckman serve goes right into the net. St. John's down five has the ball.
And to piggyback that, and a lot of people are saying, why are you going to give credit to Speckman? Well, Speckman's heard the cries of Orff for that slide and was able to fool St. John's into believing that she was going to set the slide instead.
Wagner targets that back right corner as well as anybody, and St. John's rattles off their second straight.
That's important again for St. John's to earn points off their serve with good defensive transition.
Off balance, Diamore serves. Barber catches the coffin corner on her end.
Barber went high for that ball, going way over the top of Hannah Wagner.
Barber with a match-high seven kills, swinging at 278 after a rough first set. Wagner responds. Here's Hawk out of the front, dug up by DeMarlo. Wood off the block. Kanavadov cleans it up, and Wirch off the arms of McCullough.
Once again, that is a matchup they want. They want anyone going into that slide move against Jordan McCullough. Comes Barber's next serve.
And Barber's next serve is her fourth service ace of the match. And Marquette has really opened it up here in set number two. Wood dug up by Speckman. Kanavadov for Orff off balance. Orff up the middle, dug up by Sanabia. McCullough kept it alive. Wood off the block. Barber cleans it up in the back. And inbounds with the swing, and a Hawk comes through.
Scrappy play on both sides. Great defense on both sides. However, the pure athleticism of Marquette's outsides right now is what's determining the victor of this match.
And blocked up front. Orff and Wirch combined. But it will be St. John's ball on the net violation.
There was a net violation by Elizabeth Orff. As she was coming up, her hand swung and touched the bottom of the net and basically scraped it all the way up to the top. However, as you said, Unkwa, that was a good block. It was still a great block move. St. John's serve receive is allowed for really easy reads by the Marquette block. They know where the ball's going. They don't have to worry about having to chase plays.
Here's Claudia Lopez checking in to serve for the Red Storm. And the big block on the Orff swing. Checked at the Hawk swing. And that's Wirch responding for Marquette. And McCullough catches that back left corner. St. John's with keeping only Moss in the front row alongside the two freshmen. Try and push St. John's a little bit closer. And Wirch right up the middle. Gets it past Lopez.
That's what we would consider a screen in volleyball right there, where a middle drives on a perfect pass and screams and yells to the point where the backside blocker, the weak side blocker, doesn't remember that there's another hitter there and leaves an open court. Wide open for that attack.
So here's Martha Kanavadov with the serve for Marquette. 3 points away from a 2-0 set lead. Make that two on Anna Hawk's delivery.
And the struggles continue for St. John's. Marquette is just executing their game plan right now. They are putting the ball on St. John's in smart spots and in difficult locations.
Wood off balance, blocked by Rosenthal, and Hawk up front. And it's set point for the Golden Eagles.
As soon as the setter has to leave that little target area, that little circle area over the St. John's logo, it allows that middle blocker to know I can go left or right and to not worry.
Moss tries to respond. Speckman cleans. And the pancake is not enough as Hope Wirch continues her strong match. 8 kills to take over the lead for the match. And as we head to intermission, Marquette takes a 2-0 set lead. We'll be back with more as the Golden Eagles look to start their 4-game home road stretch on a high note. Back after this on ESPN3.
Marquette and St. John's looking to go to set number three and close it all now. As we welcome you back courtside, Unqua Sonia alongside former St. Francis Brooklyn assistant Patrick Dietz. And Patrick, as you take a look at both of these teams so far, it's amazing the difference between the attitude of both teams, of course, with obvious reason, but that's also been reflected in how Marquette executed offensively in set number two, swinging 341.
And you know, I've been in the volleyball game for a long time, you know, basically since I was a kid, and I've been coaching for years, and you can see when a team isn't happy and is struggling to figure out who they are again. I remember the beginning of the year, I had the opportunity to watch St. John's play Sacramento State and just saw an excited, happy, ready team just going out there and leaving on the court and beating a really tough West Coast team in five. Then I saw them again play against UConn, a former Big East contender, and battle and win, or I should say, and lose in five. This team right now just seems like they're trying to figure out who they are all over again later in the season because of their struggles, because of what's been going on the court with serve receive, people switching in and out from starter to backup. So it really affects the psyche of a player, but that's what senior leadership's for. That's what you're supposed to help those young players figure out what they have to do.
And on the other side from Marquette, as we mentioned, a very young team looking to reload. But so far, they've seemed very, very poised, not just in their offensive attack, but the way they've been able to counter seemingly every swing that St. John's has to offer. And you can credit a lot of that to the work of the libero, Martha Kanavidoff. And she's only got five digs, but Lauren Speckman also has five digs. And digs across the board, this team as a whole, very cohesive defensively.
And that defensive cohesion is allowing for them to hit 341 as a team, allowing Jenna Rosenthal to hit 667, allowing Hope Wirch, who we weren't expecting to be a big offensive threat, end up being a huge offensive threat right now from the right side. So in reality, this Marquette team has just done everything they've needed to do to be effective and assert themselves as really one of the more dominant teams in the Big East.
And as we mentioned before, when Marquette makes the trip to Jamaica, Queens, New York, it usually goes five sets. In fact, the last time that St. John's beat Marquette was last year on Sunday, November the 13th, the same day that Denisha Moss set the single season blocks record. St. John's is going to have to dig deep just to get to set number four, let alone get to set number five.
This is a lineup flip right now. They're starting with Jordan McCullough front row right, which means that Julia Cast comes in immediately into the front row. And also they have their junior transfer setter on the court right now. Yan Xiao Zhao. And they're probably going to have Erica DeMarlo hit right side.
May even just be an opportunity to see what other passes can be registered as McCullough cleans up. And it is DeMarlo attacking. But it goes out of bounds. Point Marquette.
That's right. That's exactly what St. John's is doing. Erica DeMarlo is about to go hit right side. And Jiang Jing Zhao is about to set for them.
Zhao cleans it up, blocked up front, the McCullough swing. This time it is DeMarlo, no chance against Ali Barber. And perhaps, at least what I was thinking, perhaps maybe Coach Persico wanted two setters out there just to see if they could get some consistency offensively. Taking it back by Diamore. And McCullough nothing doing against Elizabeth Orff. Yeah.
the dump. Zhao cleans it up instead for DeMarlo. Cleaned up in the back by Hawk. Sanabia pops it up. And this time McCullough gets it off the hands of Kanavadov. St. John's has its first point.
It's a completely different tempo right now. Zhao's sets are a little bit higher, not as fast. It's actually throwing the timing of the Marquette blockers off just slightly.
Zhao's going to stay in the game. As Cast re-enters and brings St. John's back within one.
That was a thank you for saving me serve receive right there by Hawk. That ball is definitely out.
Sanabia couldn't quite receive it, and Zhao and McCullough couldn't quite get it over. So still that front line that St. John's likes. But with Zhao in the mix, now things get a little bit more interesting as McCullough and Sanabia will be playing more back row. And Allie Barber will come in to try and serve. Already four aces on the day. And the double touch gives Marquette the point.
Because you have a different setter on the court right now, St. John's serve receive has to be a little crisper, a little more on point. Maybe this was the goal of Coach Persico, to get the girls to focus a little bit better on serve receive.
Moss blocked up front. Marquette collects. Joust at the net. Cast can't collect. And it's 6-2 Golden Eagles.
Coach Persico's seen enough. She has seen enough. Zhao is off the court, and now they're going to go back to the regular offense with DeMarlo setting out of the middle.
And Zhao showing a little bit of promise as the second setter off the bench for St. John's. Now the service error will give St. John's a chance to climb back in it.
St. John's has been in every set up until point 18.
And the tip attempt from Hawk goes out of bounds. Point St. John's.
Hawk saw the shot. It was the right shot selection, not the best execution.
And it's an interesting spot to be in, Patrick, when you're down already two sets and it's still manageable, but you control the serve as now time is called to get a piece of tape off the floor.
Well, St. John's and Marquette have been here, and St. John's has battled back to take this kind of match to five. So I'm expecting St. John's to just bring the fire right now.
Elizabeth Orff has other ideas. As her kill up the middle gives Marquette the ball back.
Another great move by Orff, coming from that wide side and creating space into a good hitting zone for herself with the setter.
Hannah Wagner responds. And yep. It's 7-5 Marquette.
There was one of the situations where, because the pass was still in a zone that you can run your quick tempo, Hannah Wagner was able to stay behind the setter and still get a good swing.
Going cross court with the cut shot, Anna Hawk strikes again. Kill number 7 on the match.
Anna Hawk has found seam after seam after seam, or has hit high hands and tooled the block. Very consistently, great hitting by this young lady.
Hawk won a national championship with a club team before making her way to the States for college. She is nothing else if not seasoned, as Marquette picks up yet another point thanks to her.
The Engelholm Swedish native understands high-level volleyball, and she does it while she's here.
McCullough sprawls, cleans up. Cast finally nails one cross court.
We haven't really called Julia's name a lot this match because she hasn't been on the court a lot this match. They've really found a way, Marquette has really found a way to basically keep the number three kills per set hitter in the Big East off the court.
Second overall in the conference in total kills. And McCullough swing just goes out of bounds. No Marquette touch. McCullough very quietly having a solid night. Just does miss the line.
Jordan has gotten better as the year has gone on. She's improved her swinging. She's still struggling a little bit with serve receive, but she's improved her offensive prowess, and that has been major.
And an ace all the way from the back. Anna Hawk nails it.
That's a little old school deep floaty serve. That's from way back in the 1980s when people used to stand 60 feet off the court and drop it into the corners.
She's trying it again, but this time it sails. It seems like Marquette is literally just trying stuff out. Up 2-0 and a 4-point lead. Here's Barbara cross court. McCullough collects, and now she swings. Hawk pops it up. Barbara off balance gets it past D'Amore.
That's one of those unlucky plays for St. John's, but great lucky plays for Marquette. That ball just popped straight up into the air. All Allie Barbara did was track it, and then pop it over with a fist, a left-handed fist nonetheless, into the deep corner.
Jenna Rosenthal serving for the Golden Eagles. Up by five and up in the match 2-0. Off up the middle, dug up by Sanabia. Here's Kaylee Wood with the flip. Speckman collects. And Barber down the line goes out of bounds.
Another scrappy play won by St. John's because they're able to constantly find a way to get the ball back over the net.
And Wood can't quite get it over the net. And Marquette smells blood in the water. Looking to start their road trip on a high note before visiting Seton Hall tomorrow night. And blocked up front. Wirch could not beat Moss.
And that's actually the first time we've seen Wirch match up against Denisha Moss on that inside slide or back set right there. And of course, Denisha Moss should dominate in that situation, which is exactly what happened.
Moss with the most total blocks in the Big East, but responding very quickly. Allie Barber up the middle for Marquette.
Another perfect pass. Another perfect pass right into a good zone, right into basically her giant wheelhouse.
Popped it up for Cast. Joust at the net, and Moss did reach over. As she looks up at the official, Tim Stewart, and says, "Are you kidding me?" And it's 15-9 Marquette. And with that, timeout on the floor. And with a 2-0 set lead, Marquette looks to put it away. St. John's fights to stay alive. And yet again, the last time these two teams matched up at Carneseca Arena, it went five sets. Marquette had seen enough. When they saw St. John's earlier this season, it was a straight set sweep. And they'll look to try and end it all here.
And in each one of those sets, St. John's actually got progressively worse in terms of play. And Marquette just kept on cleaning up the way they play, which is basically what's going on here.
Sanabia pops it up. And St. John's can't catch a break. Asking about the double touch.
I think they called it Tim Stewart, the up referee, called a double touch on Denisha Moss after that beautiful dig by Amanda Sanabia.
Barber off the net. Sanabia cleans up. Damala with the dump. Still popped up by Marquette. And Moss blocks Wirtz up front.
That was an incredible play by Erica Damala. She actually held her hands in the air long enough to fool the blockers and believe she was setting. Then she power tipped it just past Speckelman. And Speckelman got a great up, but no one else could really hit up against the Cass Moss block.
Sanabia popped up the Hawk swing out of the back row. McCullough scooped up by Wirtz. Out of the back row, Hawk yet again. Calling her name all night for a reason. And that's killed number 8 for the Swedish Navy.
Anna Hawk did probably one of the smartest things you'll ever see a small hitter do up against a big blocker. She went higher, higher, higher with her arm swing, but cupped the ball in the area where the blockers had to put their hands up.
Cass, wanting revenge, targeted Hawk and got the kill she was looking for. Cast a quiet night, 7 kills, but swinging 4-12. Caballo serve just goes too far.
And you can say quiet night only because of the sheer lack of opportunity for her to really take swings. They just aren't there. Normally, she would have 40 swings by this time of the match, and she hasn't had that many attempts.
Anna Wagner popped up. Marquette keeps it alive. Sanabia sets it up for Cast. And she gets it right off the hands, attempting the donut.
That was a case right there where you saw what happens when St. John's is able to run their offense off good surface, even then off a good dig. You see, because they were able to establish Hannah Wagner in the first play off that dig, they were able to get Julie Cast a one-on-one, almost a one-on-none.
Hawk dug up by Sanabia. And here's Wood. The block goes out of bounds. Point, St. John's.
And off of a bad pass by Marquette, St. John's is able to set up and load up their block where Amanda Sanabia, the libero for St. John's, can be in the right spot defensively. Transition, point, kill.
Speckman trying to dump it. McCullough just missed the corner. And Erica Damalo asking for any sort of overrule.
So there's a little dash line at the back corner of every volleyball court. There are two of them, actually. And the lines ref right there stepped back, and the ball hit that line and not the actual corner of the court. The ball is out.
Back to service, Sarah Rose for Marquette. She sets it up as the pancake from Sanabia unable to be registered as Madeline Mosier gets her first kill of the match coming off the bench. St. John's will look to talk things over.
A good defensive move by Amanda Sanabia, just a little unlucky. St. John's is actually playing better volleyball right now, but Marquette is just physically out-muscling.
So this St. John's team taking a look at some of the games they have down the stretch. Tomorrow they host DePaul at home. Then next weekend we'll hit the road going to Georgetown and Villanova before cleaning up the rest of their regular season schedule against Seton Hall, Xavier, and Butler.
Now, St. John's came into today 4-7, good for 7th in the Big East, tied for 7th, rather. There's still time left, but you figure, depending on how they come out for the rest of this match, Patrick, determines whether or not they have a chance to even get in to the Big East tournament.
Let's do the math. Mathematically, St. John's is not eliminated yet. They'd have to lose their next three matches to be mathematically eliminated from possibly making the Big East tournament. The matches coming up, they actually have a great opportunity because they've beaten a lot of those teams to end up with an 11-8 record in conference, which would make them the last seed in the tournament. It's very possible. Unfortunately, their first round match might be against this Marquette team.
Just 5 points away from another straight set sweep of the Red Storm. What a bounce. Blocked up front. Rosenthal does it all herself.
Once again, there's that scouting report. Erica DeMarlo runs off the net or runs away from the right side. She will reverse flow set to who she feels would be the open hitter.
And it was Wagner at that point. Rosenthal, though, keeps it alive for Marquette. Barber's tip. It'll be Sanabia for McCullough. And once again, Jenna Rosenthal comes through.
Jenna Rosenthal is listed at 6'1". She is not 6'1". She is easily 6'5", 6'6". And she just, you see the length of her across the net, just penetrating deep on basically an inside set where there's no way Jordan McCullough is going to get past her.
Timeout St. John's, that is their last, as the numbers are not pretty all around. And so far, Marquette has kept their torrid pace, leading the Big East in attack percentage. 280 coming into today, swinging at 283 today, and owning the net against one of the better blocking teams in the country. And Jenna Rosenthal's been a huge part of it.
And really, Jenna Rosenthal has been the thankful recipient of just really good serving by Marquette and just poor serve receiving by St. John's. It's really that balance of attack serving. In other words, you're serving good zones, you're serving at people, and you're making them move their feet in an awkward way. And you being the middle blocker and going, oh, the setter's got to go that way. Oh, the setter's got to go that way. I can just wait till that ball comes out of the setter's hands and be in the right spot every time.
So Sarah Rose back at the service line, trying to finish the sweep for Marquette, but it goes out of bounds.
There's still a lot of volleyball left, and I can see St. John's making a big run. Denisha Moss has had a few key blocks this set.
They're going to need consistency from Wagner behind the line. Gilmore cleans it up. Wood tried to get it. Moss could not keep it alive.
Again, another unlucky play that didn't go. Another play, unluckily, that did not go in St. John's' way. Great pass, great play. Smart shot by Haley Wood. A lucky poke by Marquette that then goes back over the net. And Tanisha Moss just kind of not ready to play that ball.
Jenna Rosenthal already with a service ace of her own today at the service line. Marquette, here's Mosier. A roll shot just in front of Wood. And it's match point for the Golden Eagles.
Sarah Rose, who's the sub right now for Marquette, has come in and basically just taken over where Speckman. She's setting right now instead of Speckman. Speckman, the coach Tice is giving his starting setter a little respite. He's just following through with what Speckman's doing. Just set a good ball off a good dig and don't try to force anything.
Here's McCullough. Scoop back by Rosenthal. Barber to end it. Got it. And the Golden Eagles in straight sets take care of the St. John's Red Storm. 25-14,
the set number three final tally.
It was a match of one team knowing who they are, knowing their identity, and strictly enforcing who they are against a team that's still trying to find their footing back again, trying to climb that mountain to be who they've been in the past.
And this Marquette team has already knocked off two-time champion Creighton Blue Jays earlier this season, and now they head with an improved 16-7, 10-2 in the Big East record to face Seton Hall in South Orange, Jersey tomorrow evening. St. John's, meanwhile, falls to 12-14 and 4-8 in the Big East. With that, that wraps it up for us here from Karnasek Arena. Special thanks to producer and director Jasmine Blanow and our entire fantastic ESPN3 crew. Now for Patrick Dietrich. As ESPN3 brings you coverage of Big East women's volleyball. This afternoon, the 15-7 Marquette Golden Eagles start their four-match conference road trip against the 12-14 St. John's Red Storm. And with that, we say a pleasant good afternoon to you courtside. Alongside former St. Francis Brooklyn assistant Patrick Dietz, I'm Oquaz Sonier. Tonight's matchup features two teams on opposite ends of the offense-defense spectrum. Patrick, NCAA's top 20 in blocks, that belongs to St. John's. For Marquette, top 15 in every offensive category.
Top 15 for a reason. They have probably one of the best outside hitters in the Big East right now. But of course, St. John's has one of the best blocking teams in the Big East. When you have Denisha and Julia up front, not a lot of people get that ball past them. So really, it's going to be a battle of wills. Which team is going to be able to set their table the right way?
Our spotlight players were both named the co-freshman of the year in the Big East. And for St. John's, it starts with their quarterback, in a sense, in Erica DiMaulo.
And what a quarterback she's been all year. Yes, St. John's has struggled, but Erica DiMaulo has not. She's found a way to set the table every time for this young team. Being able to put the ball in key, solid spots so that the offense can run smoothly. Now the question is, will she be able to do that against Marquette's vaunted serving?
And on the other side for Marquette, setting the pace for their fantastic offense, the sophomore outside hitter, Allie Barber.
And Allie Barber became the co-freshman of the year last year because of her ability to find good shots. She went off towards the end of last year, and it's just carried into this year, hitting 4.96 kills per set. This young lady is on a tear and helping Marquette basically be on the cusp of top 25 in the NCAA.
With that, first serve comes your way next on ESPN3.
St. John's and Marquette looking to square off as both teams are returning to familiar territory. Marquette hits the road yet again. St. John's is back at home as Jordan McCullough, Kaylee Wood start on the outside. Julia Cast and Jordan McCullough will finish that lineup. In the middle, Hannah Wagner and Denisha Moss and Amanda Sanabia, the libero, opens with first serve. The first swing from Allie Barber, taken in by Sanabia. First swing of the night for Wood in the back row, taken by Anna Hawk. And coming through up front, Lauren Speckman, the setter.
Lauren Speckman did a great job right there. She noticed that the block was holding and waiting for her decision. Yeah, the block did go up a little late, but she found that little chop shot dump right there.
Speckman taking over the offense from Sarah Blazier, who graduated last year, a legendary setter for Marquette. Came on really strong in the offseason. However, due to a dispute, it'll be St. John's point instead.
A little touch shot off the top of the block right there, called by the Lions judge. And the up official, Tim Wagner, agreed with the contact.
Tim Stewart up top, Jim Kramer on the bottom, Burt Manning and Pierre Carl calling the sidelines. Glad you're joining us this Friday afternoon as Allie Barber dug up by Sanabi again. And the tip shot from Wood taken in by Speckman yet again. Barber trying to target Sanabia, nothing doing. And Cass with the first swing of the night gets her first kill.
You'll notice right now that St. John's is really putting pressure on the opening serve receive of Hope Worsh, number 8 of Marquette. They're really going to attack her right now, especially coming out of that left back zone. They don't think that she can pass consistently coming out of there.
Here's Erica DeMolo serving for St. John's. Going right for that back row, and Barber swings out of bounds. And so far, St. John's is doing a great job on that first serve and also with their swings to make sure that Barber doesn't get comfortable touches.
Yeah, exactly. That's the idea. They don't want her swinging on an open net. They're attacking a specific zone on serve receive.
And up the middle, there's Hope Wirch. Cast set up once more. Kanavidov cleans it up. Wirch blocked up front. Marquette goes it one more time. Barber dug up by Sanabia. So far, a great rally to open up tonight's match. DeMolo sets it up. And Wood, with the attempted tip shot, couldn't get it over the net.
That was a little bit of an error right there by DeMolo. That ball kind of stuck into her hand just a little bit. She wasn't able to give the great location that she's normally known for on a clean dig like that.
That'll send back Allie Barber to serve. Barber, the reigning co-freshman of the year. And credit the ace for Marquette. One of the best in the conference in doing so.
In the first matchup with these two teams, you saw a clean sweep by Marquette. The competition wasn't really close. But St. John's has since then changed their offense and changed the way that and their approach against Marquette. You can see it right now in the way they're playing.
Service error will give the ball back to St. John's. And here come the string of substitutions. And that'll send Delaney D'Amore to serve for the Red Storm.
Delaney D'Amore, who was the starting libero at the beginning of the year, is now the first person off the bench because she has such a great serve. She's now the starting DS. Has this incredible ability to put the ball in good locations. And that's right. That's what St. John's is hoping they can do right now for them.
Targeting Manon Jaquan. There's D'Amore with a fantastic dig in the back. And coming through with a big swing. Jordan McCullough, kill number one.
The Grapevine Texas native is doing a great job this year developing better shots. Right there you saw one inside seam low from the outside hand of the outside blocker.
Down the line, Sanabia's dig goes out of bounds. That's the first swing and kill of the night for Elizabeth Orth. She's one of 7 freshmen on this Marquette roster.
Amanda Sanabia has earned the libero job, and you can see why. She's in a good spot. Yeah, that was a tough dig, but that was basically an open net right there for Orth.
There's Wagner up the middle. Swing
goes out of bounds. Point Marquette.
That's a good sign, however, for St. John's when they're able to run their offense and they're able to get good passes. That will start to free up the outside hitters against this Marquette block.
There's Martha Kanavanoff winning the libero job all season. And the big block up front from Jenna Rosenthal, the all Big East first teamer.
You saw a block move right there. Marquette runs kind of what is known as a bunch read, where everyone's kind of stacked towards that middle cylinder area. They were able to actually get to the outside because they saw the pass.
Off the block, Anna Hawk comes through, the Miami transfer with her first kill of the night.
Anna Hawk's not a super big jumper, but she's a very smart swinger. She's able to find the top of the hands and tool the top of the block and get some bigger points.
Just like that, Marquette has rattled off four straight points. The overpass gives Marquette an easy swing. Cavallo took a tough one to the face, and Sanabi has to send over another free ball. This time it's Rosenthal.
Marquette's going to want to set Rosenthal as often as possible on a free ball situation. She's a better offensive threat against Hannah Wagner than she would be against Denisha Moss.
With that, Joanne Persico wants to talk things over, and St. John's on the wrong side of a 5-end spike from the Marquette Golden Eagles. Let's hit the break. Well, the Marquette Golden Eagles have taken control early and set number one, rattling off five straight points. And we welcome back to the broadcast across Sonia Patrick Deep on the side. As five becomes six with the errant swing up front.
And what's going on is exactly what we talked about in the opening. Can St. John's serve receive withstand the tough serving from Marquette? That's really where they struggled a lot when they were up at Marquette earlier this year.
Cavallo trying to set it at the net for an easy swing for Wagner. Marquette has started to pull away.
Erica Cavallo flew into the pole and the referee stand right there. Coach Persico got up to see if she's okay.
Thankfully, she is. Now, a little out of sorts. St. John sends up a free ball, but Hannah Wagner comes through with the solo block.
Hannah Wagner did a great job right there holding her hands high and allowing her body to just get in front of the hitter's shoulders and see the turn and jump into that swing. It's a very good job of remembering your scouting report.
And now she's back at the service line after a time where she was subbed out for, and Wagner very good at the service line for St. John's. But the block up front gives a point and ball back to Marquette.
That was actually a very good play. Denisha Moss was there. There's a little bit of space between her and the net, so the Marquette hitter was able to squeeze that ball through.
Hope worked serving for Marquette. McCullough threw the block this time. Sanavia digs the Hawk swing. Wood blocked up front. Rosenthal and Hawk combined.
That's the second time that we've had a good, clean dig from Amanda Sanavia or Delaney D'Amour. And DeMarlo went back set to Haley Wood, and easily Marquette was there. There might be a situation where there's a scouting report saying, hey, when she gets a dig and she has to run one way, she's going to reverse set reverse the flow, as we call it. So now maybe there's going to be a little adjustment on St. John's part to know that and set a different type of offense.
And that'll hopefully make Amanda Sanabia's job easier, not having to worry too much. But as she threw one arm out there, big swing from Marquette yet again, showing why they pace in the top 15 of the NCAA in offense. Allie Barber will return from Manon Geoffroy, who was her defensive replacement. And here's Anna Hawk, aforementioned, to serve. Hawk, the transfer from the University of Miami, notched a career-high 19 kills in the win against Creighton. But her service area will give St. John's the ball back.
This is the lineup that St. John's really likes having in front row, with Damalo, Moss, and Cass front row. It's good blocking, good defensive transitioning, and of course, easy offense.
Jordan McCullough with this serve. Rosenthal blocked up front. Over goes a free ball. Here's Cass, and she gets it past the sprawl of Anna Hawk.
There you saw an example of why they love this front row right there. Julia Cast is committed to blocking the side behind the setter or blocking the setter. As a result, she was able to go one-on-one with the slide and really allow Denisha Moss the freedom to reign around the net.
Sanabia digs it. Cast keeps it alive, and Sanabia sends over a free ball. Here's Barbara once more, off the hands of Damalo.
Believe it or not, that's actually a very good matchup for St. John's more than it is for Marquette. Yes, Barber's taller, has a great range of shots, but Damalo is a very smart blocker. She's going to do what is known as touch blocking, stopping the ball barely, giving the offense an opportunity to get around her.
There's Cass beating the double block.
Defense, I apologize. They have the defense work around her because she takes smart block moves and takes away zones, allowing Amanda Sanabia or Delaney D'Amore an opportunity to really see where to set up for their digs.
And this is why it's really important for St. John's having a setter who's 6 foot is able to sort of be a Swiss Army knife offensively. But the net violation will give Marquette the point.
A little unlucky right there for St. John's. Very good defensive move. That ball's a little tight. Damalo went up looking to power tip it, and on her follow-through, caught the top of the net.
Rotation starts over again with Speckman notching the ace.
We call that on the beach the hubby wife. Usually you have to go get a lawyer when you see two people battle over a ball and neither one of them move.
This time, Lexi Lobdell, who just checked in, pulls it in. And the double touch from Marquette will give St. John's the point and possibly some much-needed momentum. St. John's wearing their alternate red uniform with navy shorts. Marquette in their light blue tops, navy shorts. Damalo to serve for the Red Storm. Up the middle, Wirsch dug up. Wagner responds up the middle.
There was a situation right there where you saw how St. John's block can almost ignite their offense. Being able to soft touch that ball gives Amanda Sanabi or any defensive player back there an easy touch, and then they're able to run tempo off that good touch.
Works with the swing, nice dig in by Sanabia. Wood up front. Once more, great dig by Sanabia off of the big swing from Works. Cast cut shot. This time it's Works. And Wood mishandles the unlucky St. John's roll.
Unlucky is right, they were there defensively. She was in the right spot, and then all of a sudden, watch how this tip doesn't clear the net completely, and it hits the top, and it really foils Haley Wood's ability to play the ball.
And there's a lot happening at once to ask her to sort of step back. But there comes another race as Allie Barber matches her second of the match.
Once again, it's that serve-receive that they really struggle with. They really need to find a way to attack this serve.
This time it goes straight into the net. And Patrick, this is a Marquette team that lost a lot of pieces. Two go to graduation. They're starting setter. They're starting LeBaron, starting middle blocker, and Megan Neiman, who set countless records. But then Taylor Lewis transfers to Ohio. So this is a pretty fresh group still coming together, but have still managed to make their way into the Big East top four.
And it's really because of the tenacity of the coach and how he's gone out and trained his players, no matter what age they are, whether they're freshmen or sophomores. There's an expectation of them to step in and step up right away.
Anna Hawk is pleading with the up official, Tim Stewart, for a touch on the hand. But to no avail. So, 4-point lead for Marquette. Diamor serves. And Elizabeth Orff puts it away.
Elizabeth Orff made a great move right there. Came around quickly, tracked the ball, found the ball. And what we say is put the ball away. As soon as you see that the block is late, hit a little crossbody shot right there.
There's McCullough blocked up front, but out of bounds, point, St. John's.
Jordan McCullough has done an excellent job this year as a freshman, not just stepping in as a big hitter, but helping out Coach Joanne Persico that you see right there find a new offensive threat since, you know, this is Julie Cass' senior year. They're basically going to have to build this offense around her and Haley Wood for next year.
What a scramble for the second pass, but Denisha Moss still puts it away for her first kill of the night.
That is, you will never see that happen a lot. A perfect pass from the middle. Hannah Wagner steps in. And then the other middle, Denisha Moss, the human wall, steps up with her offensive ability this time.
Off the slide, Wirtz beats the block off the hands of Jordan McCullough up front. And Marquette in the lead, 20-16, looking to take control and take away set number one.
Hope Wirtz right there ran a very good slide. She's probably the highest jumper on the Marquette team.
Set from Moss up the middle, blocked up front. Jenna Rosenthal with Lauren Speckman.
Again, there goes that bunch read situation where the blockers are in tight into that middle area. So it's not much of a move for Rosenthal to get there and seal that gap space, that 31B shoot low ball in the middle. So because they run that bunch read, it's really simple for them to just, oh, that's where the ball is. I'm going to drop. I'm going to take a little hop step, close that little seam, and take away that shot.
For St. John's, who struggled for five sets with Xavier last Sunday before coming away with the five-set win, now sort of have to regroup against a Marquette team that they play against really well here in Karnesek Arena.
Yeah, you and I were talking before the open today. Not a lot of people like going to the Upper Peninsula. Not a lot of people like going to play Marquette at Marquette. A, it's cold. Even in the summer, it's freezing. And B, it's just a really long ride. And once you get there, you really have to adjust to a lot of things. It's not a big metropolis. It is a small city. And as a result, you're not used to having those creature comforts. And then you've got to play a volleyball game. And then you've got to play a volleyball game against a team that all they do is reload, which is something St. John's used to do in the past, but have struggled with finding those little pieces. You know, you get the DeMalos, you get the Casts, you get the Mosses. But every year, Marquette has found a way to always be competing for top 25 in the nation.
St. John's trying to get back there, and Wood out of the back row, trying to help them at the very least salvage the set.
And to finish that point, Marquette has been one of those teams that, since they've joined the Big East, has always found a way to be in the top four, top five, top six of the Big East. So you have to match.